these novels regarding late nature's birth week. And please, think of a person as the end of the presentation will be a move up. Please be fairly run out of love.
Rainforests like their football fields, the drop of for government regulation. Newsflash, nothing's gonna change unless you guys step up. And I love this graphic, a student in Australia shared it with me, and it's about all of the entry points to making a difference. So how do we tackle global warming, climate change? Step by step, little by little, you guys are all speaking about these issues in your simulation, yeah? Where do you start? You start with one problem. You start coming up with one solution. And so this, for me, changed my whole perspective. I thought, okay, I can take action. I can make a difference. And if you go back to what was the slogan of your conferences, every action, global reaction, every single thing you do adds up to a bigger whole. But I struggled. I thought about this idea of heat in my mind. How could I talk about the environment when people don't have? Right? You don't have food to put on your table. You don't have water to drink. You don't have a roof over your head. Who's going to care about this in a world like you're saying? Well, I love this. Here. Can you see this? Helen? No, it's not. We lost our home, our beautiful paradise island is no more. Where can we go now? And it's a picture of a UN officer. And he's telling them that climate change refugees aren't real. You guys are here at modeling refugees. So this is, I think, really exemplary. The issue of the environment is one that affects all of us. We have one plan that we all share. What you do here in Mexico affects me in the United States. What they do in, you know, Eastern Africa affects people in Northern Asia. It's all connected. And so we think that these issues of climate change don't affect us all. But what about the economic ramifications of people losing their homes? I think some of you are taking on the economic issues associated with refugees or climate change. It's huge. And people are trying to tell me that the environment wasn't a pressing issue. Might not be so immediate, but for some people, a country is literally going under more and more every year. I say that's a pretty pressing issue. So it leads me to this idea of doing. And you have all stepped up in such a powerful way. You're here. You are leading the change. The Dalai Lama was once asked what the most pressing problem in our world's face. What do you guys think he said? You can just shout out. What do you think the Dalai Lama said the most important issue on Earth today is? Poverty. Yes, that was the one shout out. Pollution. Respect. Global warming.
Trashing each other, and we're not even having fun. The good thing is that when we tell you, I love that Pantene Pro V. Of the dozen or so personal care products that I use every day, it's the one I can't live without. Says it gives my dull hair the ultimate cool shine. How does it do that? I was wondering that when I was lathering in my hair one day, so I read the ingredients right here. Sodium borate sulfate, tetrasodium EDTA, methyl isothiazolinone. What is this stuff? I took this list to some scientists who know how to read it. Turns out my Pantene contains a chemical linked to cancer. And lots of other products in my bathroom, from sunscreen to lipstick, and even baby shampoo, also contain chemicals linked to cancer or other problems like learning disabilities, asthma, and even damaged sperm. Like most parents, I try to keep my family safe. But now I find out my bathroom's a minefield of toxins? What are we supposed to do? To find out the answers, we have to go back to one of the key features of our materials economy. Toxics in, toxics out. If, at the factory, you pour toxic chemicals into the product, like baby shampoo, you're going to wind up with toxic baby shampoo. And toxics in workers, communities, and babies. So let's take a closer look at this toxic outrage where it seeps into our lives every day, in the bathroom. The average woman in the U.S. uses about 12 personal care products daily. The average man about 6. Each product containing a dozen or more chemicals. Less than 20% of chemicals in cosmetics have been assessed for safety by the industry safety panel. So we just don't know what they do to us when we use them. Would you fly an airline that only inspects 20% of its planes? Of course, not all of these chemicals are dangerous, but we know that many are. Some are carcinogens. That means that they can cause cancer. Others are neurotoxins and reproductive toxins, proven to mess up brain development and production in animals. Wait a minute, we're animals too. It's like a giant experiment. We're using all these mystery chemicals and just waiting to see what happens. One thing we do know is that they're getting inside us. I had my body's toxicity levels tested, and I'm loaded with things like mercury, flame retardants, triclosan, and lead. We all are. Even babies are being born pre-polluted. Now, I know we can't live in a lead-free world, but do we have to put lead in our lipstick? I don't know. Maybe it's my fault. Maybe I just bought the wrong thing. At the store, the choices seem endless. I can get lipstick in 49 shades, or shampoo for hair that's too dry, oily, fine, limp, or frizzy. But what about the choices that really matter? Like the choice of my products that are safe? It turns out that important decisions don't happen when I choose to take a product off the shelf. They happen when companies and governments decide what products should go on the shelves. So who are these companies? This is Procter & Gamble. They're the ones offering these herbal essences, the number two shampoo in the country. It contains toxic petrochemicals made from oil. That's why it's oil and herb. On cosmetics labels, words like herbal, natural, even organic have no legal definition. That means that anybody can put anything in a bottle and call it natural, and they do. I mean, can you imagine a top seller called Petro Essences? Gross. What's even nastier are hair cleansers marketed to 5-year-olds and skin whitening creams. These are super toxic, both in their ingredients and in the message they send about what beauty is. Ooh, here's Estee Lauder offering me a chance to help find a cure for breast cancer. That's nice. But wait, they're also using chemicals linked to cancer. Don't you think the best way for Estee Lauder to fight cancer is to stop using those chemicals in the first place? So really, I get to choose between meaningless claims on a bottle. But these guys get the real choice about what goes into those bottles. And that happens back here, at the factories where they're formulated. Why do the makers of these products use all these toxins? Are they trying to poison us? No, they're just working from a 1950s mindset where people were totally swept up in better-looking food chemistry. In all that excitement, they forgot to worry about human health impacts. That was years ago, and they're still using these same old toxic chemicals. Today, big cosmetics companies say the doses of poison in the products are small enough to be harmless. Yeah, maybe if you use them once a year. I guess they never get out and see that the products are being used in combined with other products every day. A little toxic dose under your arms, a little more on your hair, on your lips. And workers in nail and hair salons get dosed all day long. So the industry is used to doing things this way. And they can. Because even now that scientists have linked the chemicals they're using to all sorts of problems, there are no laws to get rid of them. Here's the thinking, really? Come on, nobody's making sure that the stuff we smear all over our bodies is safe? Nope. The FDA doesn't even assess the safety of personal care products or their ingredients. Since 1938, they've banned just 8 out of over 12,000 ingredients used in cosmetics. They don't even require that all of the ingredients be listed on the label. Now, this is an example where we can all agree a little more government action would be helpful. This lack of regulation is a huge hole that the cosmetics industry is all too happy to fill. They set up their own committee to self-police their products, and compliance with their recommendations is voluntary. So the cosmetics industry is making the rules and then deciding whether or not to follow them. So you see, it isn't our fault that these toxic products are in our bathrooms. It's a whole broken system that's ignoring a simple rule. Toxics in, toxics out. But we're not helpless. There are resources online that we can use to protect ourselves by identifying the best possible choices in the store. But the real action is with people working to change the system. Because if we really want to solve this problem, we got to start here with these guys. Women, parents, workers, people all over the country are demanding that Congress pass a new law, giving FDA the power to make sure that our personal care products are safe. We need common sense laws based on the precautionary principle. That means if we're dealing with hazardous chemicals, just err on the side of caution. Let's not debate how much lead should be allowed in lipstick. Just get the toxic chemicals out of our products. Smart laws will force companies to get past that old 50s mindset and figure out how to use all clean and shiny without toxic chemicals. Can they? Totally. Many responsible cosmetics companies are already putting safer products on the market. Green chemists are developing substances that are designed to be safe and non-toxic in the first place. European governments have required removal of many toxic chemicals, and companies have figured out how to comply. When cosmetics are reformulated to be safe and labeled honestly, then we can feel comfortable with the choices available at the store. We can choose bouncy hair or full hair, shiny lipstick or matte. We can even choose to do beautiful without using toilet products. But we'll know that whatever we choose, the most important choice, the choice to be safe and healthy, has already been made.
Our truth. And that was the beginning of Team Strength Hearing. And this is my nonprofit. like gargoyles, and some of them really caught fire, so I want to highlight two of them for you today. One is called the Conscious College World Tour, and this is a really beautiful program.
What does conventional
every day, for better corporate citizenship, for better corporate practices, simply through the purchases that you make, that your parents make, and your school makes. And we talk a lot about this with kids, so really emblematic things like fact checks, like a single-use water bottle or a single-use plastic cup versus a multi-use one, like a peanut butter and jelly sandwich. These all become symbols of what you and I can do better. It's not just a peanut butter and jelly sandwich, it's where all the ingredients come from, came from, what it's packaged in, what the impact is from a nutritional standpoint on your body. It's an apple. What should be in an apple? Items, okay, apples. The fruit itself. But conventional apples, on average, have the pesticide residue of 42 chemicals. That's wrong. That's part of this broken system. That's an apple. That's fundamental. And these are the sorts of changes that I get to go around and make with young people like you guys every day. And through our challenge, we take on one of these issues every single day. I would challenge all of you guys to sign up next year. It's a 30-day challenge. Honestly, I don't even care what your passions are. I want you to be passionate about something. And here we give you 30 ideas. Is it fair trade? Is it legislation? Is it food? Is it women's rights? Is it energy and resources? What do you guys care about? What do you want to take on? What impacts you on the day to day? This is an example of one whole chance of a calendar on sustainable agriculture. We show you guys video, we show you all sorts of things. And then when it comes down to it, it's a multifaceted approach. So my mom and I were talking about this last night. How do you find your sweet spot? You guys are going out into a crazy world, and you're navigating, you're discovering your passions, you're discovering your skill sets. And it's the place where that aligns with respect for the environment. That's the planet piece. It's the place where that aligns with moderate social justice and human rights. That's the people piece. And it's the place that allows you, as an individual, to grow. Because here you guys are, and you have this unique luxury of being students. You have this time in your lives where a lot is given to you. But once you go out on your own, there's a lot of activists, there's a lot of people in the realm of human rights, of international aid, of development, that don't sustain themselves. And that's equally important, that's the problem. The profit's not a dirty word, the profit at the expense of the environment, or of humanity, yes. But I want you all to look for those intersections, because that's the magic of the world, and that's what propels you to keep on going. And for me, I add two other pieces to it, which are the purpose, the passion, and that's the spark, that's what really, really lights your fire. So this is a person. This is each of us. And I'm going to be really specific about my journey, so you know what gives me any authority when I have to hold the microphone on my hand and stand on stage in front of you. And talk about you and all of the different aspects of you as a human being. And how you can literally channel every single one to be aligned with your values. About how you apply. It's about how you share and consume information. You guys have such unprecedented ability to amplify whatever you're thinking, feeling, believing, because of these. When I started Teams Turning Green, Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, Pinterest, Instagram, Snapchat, didn't exist. I'm not much older than you guys. The way that you have these tools in high school, how can you use them for good? How can you, as a both user and consumer of content, but also as a generator of content, you guys can produce a video. video? Literally in 6 seconds. What are you gonna do with that power? Are you gonna keep, basically gossiping and showing your friends to make you giggle, or are you going to speak out and speak up? You saw it happen with the Arab Spring and the role that social media played. It's unparalleled, and this is just the beginning. So think of yourselves not only as consumers of content, but as creators of content, and own that sharing ability. And your role in community. So this is where I go to the ripple effect idea. You guys will go home, you'll leave here today, and you'll probably talk about something that you came over to master tomorrow, talk about what you walk away with from this simulation. You are influencers. You have younger siblings, you have younger classmates, you have parents. Guess what? Your parents listen to you a lot. And if you go home and you tell them about what you believe in, you ask them to do differently, you want them to take a stand, you go to them with facts, with your platforms, with your passions, they're going to listen. The media is going to listen, professionals are going to listen, because they don't get to hear from young people every day. That's rare, that's unique, and ultimately, you know, the answer. When you have literally lost everything, like 300,000 deaths, capital city, down to rubble. Teach you how to teach, your students want to learn. Because they've been out of school for 3 months, that is a privilege and a luxury that you guys have. But it wasn't just that he wanted any school supplies. I started talking to him about recycling paper, and he said, oh yeah, yeah, that makes sense. I talked to him about pencils being sourced from sustainable wood. Yeah, yeah, he got that. When you're building a country, when you're building it, economy, build it better, build it smarter, build it wiser. I spent time studying in the Middle East, and I wrote a book about the first ever environmental education center in Palestine, in the West Bank. And this is a place that's not even recognized as a country by the United Nations. It's not even technically on the map. And these people are facing persecution and violence every day. But I developed this curriculum around environmental education. Why? Because it's a shared take a risk.
bigger. You feel greater because who cares? Ultimately, you guys are most unfortunate with your own parents. But guys, I know you think that you're really old and you've lived a lot, so much is waiting on every one of your moves. But it's okay if you take the risk and you mess up. There are people that got your back. And if you can make those steps and take those risks now, you'll have such a leg up on your peers when you really are entering the real world after school. If you can go forward and learn your lessons, it's only learn from experience. You don't learn from not playing your conference. You guys can sit around and talk about everything, how this should happen. Guess what? You did it. You learned. You're here. Congratulations. Next time, you'll do it even better. But you could never achieve the magic that's in this room without actually someone saying, go. So go there. Do that. And I think that when we, in our lives, she said, how can you
Awesome question. Yeah. My friend over here who raised his hand.
And so for me, that's been a huge obstacle, a huge realization to let myself free of those battles I was putting on myself. Because I think so many of the obstacles that we face are only obstacles for now. If we change how we see them, we there change the outcome. I've been shut down a heck of a lot of times for being a woman. And I've been talking about it more and more because I think as I grow up, I become not just a little girl, but a woman. You see it. You walk into the boardrooms. The balance is so skewed, you can't even believe it. What women have to do to get to the same places as men. In politics, you don't see them there. You see a few far between. So I think that just continuing. She said that the idea of conventional unconscious was one that she wanted to focus on and how she made those choices that her life was on. Yes, okay, wonderful. So here's what I'm missing. As far as I'm concerned, I'm thinking about it as a spectrum. Conventional unconscious. You know, we all exist somewhere in the middle, right? None of us are all good or all wrong. Conventional healing.
Thank you.
I graduated from college and knew that that was coming about a year and a half ago. While I had developed a job and developed demand for what I was doing outside of school, it was not enough for me to support myself. So there was that way of sustainability at the personal level. And I had all my mostly friends and parents and my family. You know, I was with my family at Christmas 2 years ago. Everyone was going, Erin, what are you going to do? And I had this moment. I called my mom and I said, what am I going to do? I have to get a real job. I have to have most of you. You know, and she said no. She said, we're going to make okay. I don't care any action steps. I'm going to figure out how to go forward. That was really, really hard. And the easiest thing to do would be to do like us and my friends did and find a job. I can still be passionate about other things. I can still care about causes on the side. But for me, that was a real conflict. This sounds cool, silly, and frivolous, but the San Francisco Chronicle, which is the newspaper, I did this whole brain dorm thing, and I was going off to college, and it was on the front page, and I was so excited, and it came to my house, and it was a really big honor, and it went live, and it went online, and it had obviously my name and all the details, and there were thousands of comments that tore me to shreds. Thousands of people went online, most of them didn't use their real names, who used, you know, whatever, pen names, hit behind pseudonyms, and said everything that was wrong with me. Then wrote that my feet were too big. I don't know if you can tell, looking. Like, I think my feet are pretty normal size. But this is what they decided was so important to take me down. That I was a trust fund baby. The only way I could possibly be doing this is if I were independent enough. I guess I'm really an honest conception. I'm not. I went to school on scholarship for my whole life. Because I followed my passion, people assume that I must have some safety net, right? And I read these comments, and I said, that's it. It's not worth it. I'm trying to do everything that I think is right. And if people are going to still tear me down and discredit my cause, then give up. Don't. Because there are people for every one of them, there's millions of people that want to listen to you and want to meet you. And all it takes, seriously, is one comment from one person that you made a difference. So, like, stroke your ego, because in the world of activism, in the world of humanitarian, in the world of social justice, it's hard. It's really, really hard. It's an uphill battle every day. But by sharing my story, maybe it gets through. When you say something like that, that you're feeling inspired because I'm here, you have no idea. So thank you, but keep going.
When you first think about our life, what was your first birthday by? What was the first thing you could do?
And we were high school students who could do it just like all of you. Are you getting paid to be here to do modeling?
pop the tube. If you finish your suns, pop in the box. If you were done with your shampoo, give us the bottle. And we brought them all together and we've done the test. I did not do well in biology in the chemistry, and those of you who are worried about it, you know, there's different strengths. So I'm going to list the wisest chemist that I knew. The volunteers came in to our house on a Sunday morning, and we sat around the town, and we wrote down the names of the creators.
Dabble Thank you. segundo deseo de paz del Pan American School.
¡Gracias!